Academy for giving me opportunity to give my work. So I'm just talking about the wild gingers and bananas of India. And mainly I am talking about the taxonomy part only. Apart from this, I have done the molecular work, anatomy, then palynology, pollination, etc. And here I am going to present only the taxonomy. So presently I am working as CSIR Emeritus Scientist at Malabar Botanical Garden. And there is a site, gingersofindia.com, that you can go and check. Then this, hearing gingers, mostly this, only the edible ginger come into mind, but here the gingers is the family of the Syngiberaceae, or bananas, that is the edible bananas. And this belongs to the order Syngiberales, which include 8 families, and of which 5 are present in India. And here I am going to present only the ginger family, the Syngiberaceae, and the banana family, the Musaceae. And the Syngiberaceae form the largest family of the order Syngiberales. Here you can see one rhizogram which shows the evolution of these 8 families, and which Musaceae is the most primitive and Marantaceae is the highly advanced. Here you can see the distribution of these Syngiberales, because they are mostly present in the wet evergreen forest. They are mostly distributed in the wet evergreen forests of Western Ghats, northeastern India, and Andaman Nicobar Islands. Then, coming to this knowledge of Syngiberales, prehistoric, you all know that we have been using these various species in various cultural and religious practices. And turmeric is well known, and even today it is used as prasad in temples for various religious functions. And many species are used as food and spices since time immemorial. And in Ayurveda, in many texts like Susruta Samhita, then Charaka Samhita, Ashtanga Samhara, etc., many of these species are given or used. And and you know that the patent dispute between this American company and India, and I'm not giving any. And coming to this 15th century to past, Van Reed's work is there, William Roxburgh, and the major comprehensive work was done by J.D. Hooker between 1890 and 92. And Gamble's South Indian Flora, that is the Presidency of Madras Flora. And I have revised almost all the families of these Syngiberales. And many others contributed, like Santapo and etc., etc., my students. Then coming to the uses, several species are used since time immemorial all around the world, like Alpinia galanca. It is commonly called as the rasna in Sanskrit, and it is widely used in Ayurvedic preparations. Then turmeric, cardamom, camphoria rotunda, or kachol, and Syngibera officinalis, turmeric, this ginger, etc. Then it is used on local basis. More than 30% of all species are used in India by, and tribal people and local inhabitants. Then several species are used as spices. So though that is why this family can be called as a spice family. And food also, many species are used. Ornamental also, nearly 250 species can be used as ornamental, and is also used in various rituals. Then main highlights, this revision is based on fresh collections from throughout India. So all the photographs are taken from the field only. And the first and only revision after Utkarsh Flora since 1892. And this brought out many additions to Indian gingers and bananas. Following table, you can see nearly 77 taxa were added. And about 40% of the taxa are endemic to India. That is very important. And nearly 25% of the taxa are endangered. That is another important feature of these families. Then established largest wild and ginger, these ginger and banana collections in Calicut University Botanical Garden, as well as Malabar Botanical Garden. So here you can see the habitat in Northeast India, Western Ghats, and the Andaman Nicobar Islands. And this shows our two collection trips or the explorations in 2002 and 17 in the Andaman Nicobar Islands. So similar collections every year, nearly 2 months we spend in Northeast India and other parts of India. Then genera of Syngiberaceae from India, there are 22 genera, of which only one genus, Paracamphoria, is endemic to India, and all others present in other areas also. Then coming to Alpinia, here you can see that the Alpinia, two species are endemic, and the ayurvedically very important species like Alpinia galanga and Alpinia calcareata, they are called as the kacholam, sorry, this rasna, in and many preparations, rasna, the kashayam, etc., it is used. Here you can see the different species, the diversity in India. And this one is the Alpinia galanga, and this is the Alpinia calcareata, and you can see the beautiful ornamental species. And Amomum is another genus. Now it is split into seven genera, of which three are present in India. This Wolfania, Amomum, and Meistera. You can see that all these yellow, they are endemic to India. And this is the latest classification. And you can see the diversity of these Amomums in India. And the other bottom, you can see Amomum subulatum, that is called as the large cardamom or Beda Elaichi from Northeast India, mainly in Sikkim and other areas. And most of these species, they are from Northeast India. And nearly seven species are from Western Ghats, and some species from Andaman Nicobar Islands. And some are beautiful ornamental also. And this is very recently described species Amomum ruwaichi. And you can see beautiful Amomum kingi variety of Blaungum. This is from this Sikkim. And some of these drawings of these labellum fruit and other things. And Karkuma, again coming to Karkuma, of this 39 species in India, 22 species are endemic to India. And you all know this Karkuma longa, and this much of species are endemic to India. And the variation in this rhizome, then color, etc. These are all some of the features that can be used for the identification of species. And here, see this diversity of various species. And this species is the smallest among the Karkuma, and we named it as Karkuma vamana, which is the smallest among this species. And these are from, and this is another arrowroot is extracted. And this is the flower of Karkuma longa. And here you can see some beautiful ornamental species of this Karkuma, and they can be used as cut flowers. And this is one lovely species from Andaman Nicobar Islands, this Roscoeana, Karkuma Roscoeana, and the Karkuma Pragasha from Meghalaya. And here you can see the process of taking out the starch from these rhizomes. This is the traditional way of taking rhizome. It's easily digestible kind of starch. And this is a kalam that is made from this Karkuma powder, this powder. And the Bosambari is another genus. And another important feature of this genus, these two species, Rupra lutea and Albo lutea, they are considered as extinct species. Since our last 30 years, we have been searching for that. We couldn't find out any of this. And here you can see the diversity of this Bosambari. And this is a lovely species from this good ornamental species from these Nicobar Islands. You can see this flowers. 1 month, it will be the continuously they produce. And Cotylean colocomphoria, they are high altitude species. Above 1,500, they usually grow, and they are ornamental species also. They can be cultivated and domesticated in the gardens. And here you can see this Elateria cardamom, or this spice. There are one species and two varieties from South India. Atlingira is another beautiful species. This is from Nicobar Islands. Atlingira fensley, and this is Atlingira lingiformis. And Globa is another important and good ornamental species. You can, they are otherwise called as the dancing ladies because of their flower. And here also seven species are endemic to India. Here you can see this Spathulata, then this Viniti and Globa sherwoodiana. These are all can be used as cut flowers, and this will last for 7 to 12 days. And some other diversity from various parts of India. And another good ornamental, that is Globa vengeri and Globa shamburki, and these two are good ornamentals and can be grown in gardens. And Hemiorchis and Onstantia, and they're small genera, and Panlinji one genus that is endemic, and Arunachalensis that is also endemic to India. And Hedychium is another good ornamental species. Many of these species are good ornamentals. World over, there are 80 species, and we have 44 taxa, and mostly they are in northeastern India. This is the list of that one. You can see that critically endangered 14 species are critically endangered, and endangered 13. You can note down this condition of this species in India. You can see that beautiful flowers of this Edicium species, and almost all are good ornamentals. And again, some species of this Edicium, they are very aromatic, and the perfumes can be extracted from this species. For example, Coronarium, and this is known as the Suganthi. And you might have heard of this Bhima. When in search of one flower, it is believed that this is Edicium coronarium, and the diversity of Edicium and the Sukari, it is an epiphytic species, and many of these species are critically endangered, and they are beautiful also and can be grown as ornamental species, and some more species are yet to be described. And the camphorae is another ornamental as well as medicinal species. Two species, Kachavalam, that is the Camphoria galanga and Camphoria rotunda, both are used in Ayurvedic as well as Yunani and Siddha medicines. And you can see that leaves shows peculiar pattern that is known as this, commonly called as peacock gingers. And Lassania, this is a new genus, and we have described two species, that is Arunachalensis and Assamensis. And this is also a good ornamental species. And Paracamphoria is the monotypic endemic genus from India. And Plagiostachys, a new genus record and a new species we have described. And here you can see this we have collected just before the tsunami. And after tsunami, nearly 75% of these plants have been destroyed. So we have started conserving this species. And Rhynchops and Staglianthus, only two species are present, Longiflorus and Involucratus. And Roscoe is another genus which grows at high altitude above 1500. It's a good ornamental species, and two species are endemic. And Singiba, this last genus, India has 26 species and 7 species are endemic. And this is the genus, or the Singiba officinale, is the edible ginger that we use. And again, some species are also widely used. Here you can see that Clarke, this shows this terminal inflorescence, whereas the chrysanthemum and almost all species, you can see that the basal flowers produced, and Animalianum and Capitatum also produce terminal inflorescence. It is a good ornamental species. And these some species, this is the flower of our Singiber officinale, or this edible ginger. And this is Neotrunchatum, is a new record for India. And Montanum is a good medicinal plant, which widely cultivated for various Ayurvedic preparations and for also local uses. And this is a species recently described from Pune area, Singiba divakarianum. And this is a species named after me by students. And this is from Western Ghats. And this is another Odoriferum from Nicobar Islands. It is also, you can see that inflorescence and white flowers, and they are also good ornamentals. And this Sarumbeti is widely distributed throughout India. And coming to this Musaceae, you all know that this Musaceae, this family, when I started revising, there were hardly 12 to 15 known species in this two genera, the Sensata with the two species and Musa with nearly 12 species. But after our revision, it has come to 38 taxa, and taxa endemic to India, 27 taxa. Now it is believed that this genus has the center of origin in northeastern India. And these all are many species we have described, and many species described by some other from Gogoi, etc. From here, you can see the diversity of this Musa. This Sensata glaucum, there are two species, the Sensata glaucum and Sensata superbum. And one is from Northeast India, the other from this superbum from Western Ghats. And all others, they are distributed widely in Northeastern India, and few in Western Ghats and Andaman Nicobar Islands. So So this Mausachuni is a good ornamental species, and all the wild species that can be identified, when you cut open these fruits, they are filled with seeds. And another importance of these wild species, all our edible bananas, the progenitors of these are the Musa acuminata and Musa bulbiciana. And these two, by crossing or some other methods, they formed our present day edible bananas. And these bananas can be used for developing our new edible forms. And here you can see Musa aurantiaca. It's also a good ornamental species. And these are the Indo-Andamanensis, Flaviflora, Musa cylindrica. These are all new species described by us. And Musa camangensis, Musa cartuverna, and Musa manni. And this species, it was described nearly 120 years back. After that, nobody collected, but we could recollect it after 120 years. And Musa marcui and Musa nagensium. And this species, Musa sanguini, is again considered as extinct in the wild. And this is another species described by our students from Nicobar Islands. This is Musa sabuana. And Musa rubra is another ornamental species, the nornata. These are all terminally producing flowers. And Pushpanjali, this is from Arunachal Pradesh. This is the largest banana. And you can see that the weight of this inflorescence may come around 75 to 80 or even 100 kg. Then and another very important species is Musa velutina. Here you can see that the self-feeding nature of these fruits. This is the only species which shows this kind of opening of these fruits, so that can be easily disseminated through birds and other animals. And another feature we noticed in the wild, most of these bananas, their flavor and the taste is very good. So tasty, so most of this can be used for developing new edible bananas. This is a very good ornamental. I love this plant, Musa hakineni. And you can see that nearly 2 months it will remain the bracts, which remain adhered to this inflorescence. Normally, the second day, most of these bracts fall off, but here it remained together. And these are some of the conservatories we have made, developed in Calicut University. And this forms the largest collection in India and also the third in the world. This ginger, nearly we have conserved 22 genera of Cinciparaceae and 2000 accessions. 22 genera, then 200 species, and nearly 2000 accessions. And coming to this banana, we have nearly 300 accessions and nearly 32 species. And this is the newly constructed ginger house at Malabar Botanical Garden. And this is the ginger villa. And this is supported by DBT, DST, and BGCI London. And digital herbarium also we have prepared, and referring to almost all these herbaria in India, BSI and other herbaria, we have prepared the digital herbarium, and also digital flora of Cinciparaceae, including all the details of these Cinciparaceae members as well as Musaceae. And one website I mentioned earlier, the gingersofindia.com, and here most all details are available, but just now it is under so I take this opportunity to thank these are my students, and they worked in various projects, and this middle one is Jana Skornikova from Czechoslovakia, and she is now in Singapore, and all others are well placed. And I should thank the DST SERB, then DBT, BGCI London, then MOEF and CC for various support, project support and financial assistance. And Botanical Survey of India, mainly because all these herbarium specimens we are referred, and literature also we are referred from Botanical Survey of India. and forest departments. Without their support, this would not have been done. So forest departments of various states. So I thank all my students, my colleagues, and also the funding agencies. So I once again thank the Academy for giving this opportunity.
Thank you very much, Professor Sabu, for taking us through this absolute wonderful encyclopedia of Indian bananas and gingers. I know that you said you have done a lot of work on the pollination biology of many of these species, because just looking at the flower structure, one is amazed at, you know, the complicated biology that must be present to actually, you know, produce viable seeds. And you also mentioned about the wild bananas. When you cut them, they are full of seeds, which is not like our cultivated bananas.
Yes, yes.
So I think we would love to hear you at another time talk to us about the pollination of these wonderful species,
that's
also, particularly the gingers, because the flower structure is so amazing.
Yeah, we made some hybrids also for Alpinia, as well as some bananas hybrids we have developed.
There are no questions as I see, but as I said, you have really taken us on a journey throughout India, and you have shown us all these amazing plants, and having at least two of them named after you, I think, is a marvelous achievement. So thank you very much for this wonderful talk.